Historical Society in very good stead for next year. Let's think about our own lives and what we've done up to this point and what we and the work we still have to do. And I think that's probably what we're going to find out about tonight from Rabbi Cohen. Rabbi Daniel Cohen, I first met you, I think, at Borders. Remember, there used to be a bookstore called Borders. It's now Trader Joe's. I like Trader Joe's, but I miss having Borders out here in the burbs as opposed to downtown. But anyway, every time I would go there, I think I ran into you, Rabbi Cohen. And so that was just a foreshadowing, a hint about how interested he is in reading and writing and studying. And Rabbi Cohen possesses a unique blend of authenticity, wisdom, and spiritual insight for contemporary society. Rabbi Cohen has served in the rabbinate for over 20 years, and we want to know the secret for your youthful looks and actions. And you currently serve as the senior rabbi at Congregation Agudath Sholom, the largest modern Orthodox synagogue in New England. And believe it or not, Rabbi Cohen has been there since 2005. I know, that is a wow. Are you a fan of the Falcons?
Yes.
Absolutely. Okay, and Rabbi Cohen was born and raised in Atlanta, Georgia. So we actually have something in common because I'm from Valdosta. Okay, which is not near Atlanta in any way, not geographically or in any other way near Atlanta, but it is in the same state. Okay, Rabbi Cohen is a graduate of Yeshiva University in New York and is Azrieli Graduate School. He served as a national officer of the Rabbinical Council of America and is a member of the National Council of APAC, the Board of ADL, and the Bet Din of America. So if you need any decisions made, he's the guy to go to. He's like on the Supreme Court. He recently published Mining for Gold, Essays on Torah in the Modern World. And now, is this your second book, Rabbi Cohen? And there's probably, maybe there'll be a hint of more of what else is in the works. Have you heard him on the radio? Well, if you haven't, he's the co-host with Reverend Greg Dahl of the nationally syndicated radio show, The Rabbi and the Reverend. Sounds like the beginning of a joke. And it's on Sunday mornings at 11 a.m. and Sunday evenings at 9 p.m. And Rabbi Cohen and his wife Diane are the grateful parents of six daughters, Sarah Malka, Michal, Adina, Elisheva, Tamar, and Shalhevet. So, with all of that, it is a great honor and privilege to introduce Rabbi Daniel Cohen. Tell us how to make our own way.
Thank you very much for hosting this evening. I want to thank the Jewish Historical Society and Aaron from the Ferguson Library for hosting this evening. It's really a special privilege and pleasure to be here tonight for a number of reasons. This is really the first kind of, I would say, hometown launch of this book. I was in California on Sunday and Arizona on Monday and Denver on Tuesday. And it's really great to be here in the presence first of my soulmate, Diane, who really is a partner with me in writing this book. My father, thank God, who just flew in from Israel a couple of days ago, with my stepmom, Meryl. It's really a pleasure to have you here and speaking about this book. I also want to acknowledge my literary agent, who Anne-Marie O'Farrell, raise your hand. She's so critical in helping me get the book. Thank you so much. And the community, in particular, Agudath Sholom, for really being a partner with me as well. I am the full-time rabbi of Agudath Sholom, and I like to say my highest priority, I try to make it my family, then my shul, and then writing. This is really a passion for me. So it's really a pleasure to be here and to give thanks to God for being able to be here this evening. And in particular, as you'll see, it's a very meaningful night as well. Tonight is the yahrzeit, actually, of my mother, a blessed memory, who passed away in 1989, who I'll talk about in a few minutes, and I can't think of a better tribute to her to really be speaking about this book this evening. So I want to begin first by sharing a story with you that some of you might be familiar with about Alfred Nobel. We're all familiar with the Nobel Prize for which many individuals over the years have been recipients, but were not always familiar with the backstory of Alfred Nobel. What happened was, it was the day after his brother Ludwig had passed away, and on the morning of the funeral for his brother, he opened the newspaper, and the obituary was not about Ludwig, but the obituary was about him. So he got the opportunity to read his own obituary. And in it said, "We're sorry to announce the passing of Alfred Nobel, the doctor of dynamite, the purveyor of death." And in that moment, in that awakening, he asked himself, "Is this the way I want to be remembered?" And rather than let that awakening go in one ear and out the other, he decided to transform his life and not utilize his wealth for his own glory, but rather to use it to help enhance the lives of other individuals. That story encapsulates the premise of this book. This book, really, just imagine for a moment, you're walking out of a funeral, and you have a moment where you say to yourself, "I hope they speak about me the way they spoke about that individual." How many of you have felt, regardless of your faith, after leaving a funeral, you say, "Wow, I've really seen and heard something that really affects my life"? How come nobody's raising their hand? Let's be honest. You go out and you say, "You know what, I need to spend a little more time with my family. I need to focus on what's truly important in life." And then generally what happens after about 15 minutes, we go back to life as usual. And we go back to the daily routine until another awakening happens. And the truth is that oftentimes that's the way life works. It's a highlight film. There's a moment when you might say the terra firma starts to move underneath our feet. There's an inner earthquake. God forbid something happens. And I see this many times as a rabbi. I won't hear from somebody. Somebody gets sick and all of a sudden they'll call, "Rabbi, pray for me." And they get serious about life. And then when that sense of urgency leaves, then they go back to life as usual. But if that's what life is, we only get serious about sensing the urgency of life, about what's truly important, on an inconsistent basis, we're missing the potential that each one of us has to lead a life that's tuned into a higher frequency and tapping into our divine potential for spiritual greatness every day. And this book really is a journey. The book is called What Will They Say About You When You're Gone? I begin the book by encouraging people to develop the prototype of what is the life that you want to lead. How would you describe your best self? And there are questions here. It's not just a narrative, but there are actually questions to begin to think about what are those things that you believe in? What do you stand for? How do you want to be remembered? And I'll give you a sample of some of the questions to begin the journey. This, by the way, and I say this before I say these questions, is not a book about death. This is a book about life. But only by confronting sometimes our own mortality. By the way, I have a question. How many people here are alive right now? Please. I'm giving you a gift because you have the ability to take these awakenings, your confrontation with who is the person I want to be, and to seize those moments in a way that now, God willing, with good health, we can transform our lives to become better people. And here are some of the questions in the book. If you had only 24 hours to live, what would you do and why? Another question. You have 5 words to write on your headstone. What are they? Now, obviously, a book like this takes time to you reflect on it. You can read it, but it really takes sacred time to think about these things. The question that speaks to me most is this question. What is worth fighting for? And I reflect on a scene in a book by Alan Paton where a soul at the end of their life go to God. And God looks at that soul and says, "Where are your wounds?" And the person turns back to God and says, "I have none." And God says to that individual, "Was there nothing in this life worth fighting for? What do you believe in? What do you take a risk for? And knowing those things and thinking about those things help us develop that prototype. But the question really is once you develop that prototype, how do we stay attuned to that sense of urgency every moment? It's not easy. The truth is, it's a gift when we have these awakenings. King Solomon says something very stirring. He writes, "It's better to go to a funeral than to a wedding." Now, I'd rather be at a wedding. The question is, what does he mean? He was a wise man. What usually happens the day after you go to a wedding? I think I ate too much. It was fun. But when you go to a funeral, there's an opportunity for spiritual growth, an opportunity to learn. And this really is about that phenomenon. I interviewed different individuals for the book. One was the director Ron Howard, among others. And he wrote the following. I had my conversation with him. He said, "I've actually thought about that on the way back from funerals. I've actually had that specific reaction. I've had the cautionary one where I'll leave a funeral and I'll say, he was a nice guy, but nobody really had much to say about him. What does that mean about the way he lived his life? He didn't do anything wrong, but he doesn't seem to have extended himself. He doesn't seem to have reached or ever gone the extra mile on behalf of an idea, a person, or a principle. I realize that as a society, we need to take stock. It can be inspiring, or as I said, a little frightening." And I believe that when we think about this, our country will be different, and we as individuals will be different as well. Politics aside, one of the other individuals I interviewed for the book was the former mayor of New York, Rudy Giuliani. And I was in his office a number of years ago, and I said to him, "Wouldn't it be wonderful if America lived as if it was always September 12th, not September 11th? Nobody wants to repeat that day on September 11th. But on September 12th, there was a real sense of what was important in people's lives. We transcended, and we could use it, the partisan infighting, the demonization, the differences. Remembered who we were as a country. We hugged our children a little bit more. Our families, those we love." And he said, "Rabbi, I don't know how to do it, but I know exactly what you're talking about." And he said to me, "When I was the mayor of New York," anyone know? You guys should know this here. "Is Rudy Giuliani a Yankees fan or a Mets fan?"
Yankees.
That's good, because in Arizona, they have absolutely no idea. So he said, "When I was mayor of New York, and I went to a Mets game at Shea Stadium of blessed memory, I was wearing my Yankees cap. And he said, inevitably, every time I walked in, I got booed, except for one time." He said, "After 9/11, one of the first Major League Baseball games that took place was between the New York Yankees and the Mets. I think we remember this game. The New York City Fire Department was there. The Police Department was there. And he said, I walked into Shea Stadium with my Yankees cap on, and I got a standing ovation. And then he said, I knew the world was a little bit different." And that's part of the awakening we're trying to seize. I struggle with this on a personal level. A number of years ago, I had a kidney stone. How many of you have had a kidney stone before? Now, I'm going to try a test, and I'll see whether we pass. Okay, here we go. That was kind of a joke, but I'm like, I say, oh boy, that's a rabbinic joke. I'm sorry. I say kidney stone. What do you say? I say that, thank God, Diane and I have six daughters. What do you say? You know, I've actually been with groups where I get the same reaction for the kidney stone as I do for six daughters, and that's not good. But I have to say that after the kidney stone cast, there was a blessing that I recited with a lot of concentration in the Jewish faith. You even know what blessing I'm talking about. You don't have to be Jewish to give thanks. The blessing was, thank God what is open is open, and what is closed, and everything is working properly. Now the question is why wait for that moment to say that blessing? Every day is a day to be grateful. Every day, as Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel says, is to live with radical amazement. Everything is wondrous. Everything is beautiful. And that in many ways is, I would say, the challenge and the inspiration for writing this book. But most specifically, really coming from, as I mentioned a few moments ago, something that happened in my life that obviously changed my life forever. And that was the passing of my mother when she was 44 years old from a brain aneurysm in 1989. And tonight, as I said, is her yahrzeit, the anniversary of her passing. I was down in Florida with my mother's parents for a vacation, as I always enjoyed doing, being at the pool, not a care in the world. And I came up from the pool into their condominium in Aventura, and then we received a phone call that she had an aneurysm, then she had a second one. Unfortunately, she went into a coma, and she passed away within 48 hours. And our entire world was obviously turned upside down. I'm the oldest of six children. I was 21 years old at the time. And my youngest sibling was 8 years old at the time. And I always knew that my mother was young, but then really the odyssey for this book began when I was in my 40s. I really began to think a lot more, well, this is where my mother was at her point in her life, and now this is where I am in my life, and really begin to think about what does it mean, the fragility of life, and to appreciate every moment, and the legacy that I'm trying to leave. It was really beginning in that process around 6 to 7 years ago. And I'm very grateful, because I would say it was not only that thinking of 40, but I grew up certainly with a wonderful sense of trying to seize every day. This is the first time I get a chance to thank my father in public like this. But he always would instill with us, and I share this story. I still remember, I don't know if you remember this conversation we had. This is a real treat. But this is what he tried to instill within me. I was a sophomore at Yeshiva University in New York. And I remember calling my dad on the phone, and he said, what are you doing? I said, I'm thinking of going into the play. I'm getting involved in drama. There are all these things that I want to do. And then he said to me, remember why you're there. I kind of live with this moment like, focus. Keep your priorities. Don't get distracted. And I think my dad remembers this as well, that I definitely am an Atlanta Falcons fan, and it's a real treat to have this, to say that I'm an Atlanta Falcons fan days before the Super Bowl. Atlanta Braves fan, Atlanta Hawks, Atlanta Flames of blessed memory. But in my bedroom in Atlanta, I didn't have any pictures of sports heroes there. Right over my bed, there was a saying from Epics of Our Fathers, Im lo achshav eimatai, which means, if not now, when? Again, growing up with the sense that things were truly, you know, there's a limited amount of time. We need to seize every day and every moment. My mother, blessed memory, had this wonderful positive attitude. When people would ask her how she was doing, she would say, Baruch Hashem, fantastic. Thank God, things are great. So I really felt that in many ways it was so important for me and really to share ideas about how can we identify what is our best self. And then what happens in this book is there are seven principles for reverse engineering your life so you lead the life now that you want to be remembered for. Identify what is the life we want to lead, but then finding ways to lead that life on a consistent basis. So we live with more gratitude. We live with more inspiration. We appreciate that life has obstacles and find ways to move forward and certainly live with the opportunity of impact every day. So are you ready to join me for this journey for a few minutes? You good? That was weak. Are you ready? Good. So I'm going to start actually just by kind of getting you in the mood. This is a poem that you probably have heard of, but I think it helps us think about this issue of legacy. It's written by Linda Ellis, called The Dash. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of birth and spoke of the following date with tears, but he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that they spent alive on earth. And now only those who loved her know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live in love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left. You could be at dash mid-range. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real, and always try to understand the way other people feel, and be less quick to anger, and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. We treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering that this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read with your life actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spend your dash? That's it. Good night. So the question is, how do we take that inspiration and infuse every day with that sense of significance? So I'm going to share briefly three of these principles tonight with you. One is called Living Inspired. The second is called Courageous Choices. And the third is called Discovering Your Elijah Moment. I want to talk about living inspired. And it's a phenomenon that we all have a challenge with. At the very beginning of every summer, you know, you talk to people and they say, what do you plan on doing this summer? And they say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, all these different things. And then inevitably you come to them a day before Labor Day and you say, how was your summer? And what do we all say? It went by so fast. That's the nature of life. But we believe that we cannot stop time. But we do believe that it's possible to slow down time if we're present in every moment in a way that appreciates the infinite capacity in that moment for something special to happen. Robert Gruden, in his book called Time and the Art of Living, says that every day we have to ask ourselves the following question. What are we doing today that is worthy of future memory? It's not just one day runs into the next. Every day is an opportunity to accomplish something, to grow, to share some light. And thinking about that, too often people have what I call a Paul McCartney disease, or they have Annie disease. Now, I like Paul McCartney, I like Annie, but what am I talking about? Paul McCartney disease is yesterday. All my troubles seem so far away. They're living in the past. And there's Annie, tomorrow. But they're actually missing what's present and what's right in front of them. And what I explore in this chapter really is what I say, the capacity for every moment to be something eternal. And I want to share a story with you. I'm a rabbi, so I'm going to draw on the Bible a little bit. So the story actually is in the book of Genesis, where Jacob is running away from his brother because his brother wants to kill him. And he goes to sleep at night, and he puts his head down on a pillow, and he has a dream at night. What does he dream about that night? There's a ladder that he dreams of with angels going up and down. And then in the morning, he wakes up and he makes the following declaration. He says, God is in this place, and I did not know. This is the house of God, and herein is the gate to heaven. When he put his head down on that piece of ground, he had no idea at that moment that that was going to be a place that would bridge heaven down to earth. But he realized when he woke up that there's a possibility in any moment, in any time, in any place, to somehow bring some sort of meaning and spirit to that connection. The truth is, God is everywhere. The divine is everywhere. Inspiration is everywhere. The question is, are we open to it and do we let it into our lives? And I want to share a story that for me encapsulates what it means for me to live inspired. And it was a spot that I'll never forget outside security at JFK Airport. And whenever I see that spot, I say that was a holy moment and a holy spot. We sent, thank God, our daughters to study in Israel for the year after high school. And it was our second daughter, Michal. She was about to go through security. And I was struggling with thinking about, what do I want to say to my daughter when I'm not going to see her for 9 months? If I really didn't want her to talk to me, I would have given her my credit card. But I was thinking, what do I say to her? And then, out of the corner of my eyes, I saw the following. Doug, I need a volunteer. Come here, Doug. I need a volunteer. There's always one guy in the audience that I can count on. Just kidding.
That was a volunteer.
You're a volunteer. So out of the corner of my eye, I saw a father putting his head on the daughter. He was saying, may God protect you, may God shine his face upon you, and may God grant you peace. And this is real, everybody. Let us say, amen.
Thanks, man. He didn't say, look, Simon didn't say, let go.
Simon didn't say, let go. Oh. He's a blessed guy.
You feel blessed?
I do.
Good. Thank you. There you go. You're good. Give me a big round of applause. So I knew in that particular moment that that's what I wanted to think about and give that blessing to my daughter. And I'm so grateful in that moment, I wasn't looking at my device. I was open to what was happening around me. And then I was leaving the airport, and I said to myself, that really feels really good. I want to give my children this blessing every Friday night. It's from the book of Numbers. Any person, any faith, give this blessing that God should watch over you. But I had a problem. That problem was my father has a different tradition. In our home, my father would only give me this blessing right before the holiest day of the year, which is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. So I said to my dad, who's here right now, I said, Abba, I said, what, you know, I want to give the blessing, but I don't want to divert from the tradition. So my father, in his humility, said, if you have an opportunity to look your child in the eye on a Friday night and to give that blessing, that's what you should do. And then he said, if I had to do it all over again, that's what I would have done as well. So I began the tradition of them blessing our children. I go from oldest to youngest. Diane goes from youngest to oldest. There's sometimes a traffic jam in the middle. But then what happened after that was truly inspiring. I shared this in synagogue, and a fellow named Maury Rosenbaum, who some of you might know, emailed me and said, Rabbi, it's not too late for your father to start giving you a blessing. So I called my dad on the phone. I said, hey, I'm in my 40s. You're in your 50s. You're in your 70s. I said, you know, I would love for you to give me a blessing. So since that time, my father, he's in Israel. He happens to be here right now. He says, I'm looking you in the eye. I'm giving you a virtual hug. And I'm giving you that blessing. You don't even have to be present. It's over the phone. And then hours later, I'll give that blessing to my daughters as well. I share that story because it's a beautiful example of the power of finding those sparks everywhere and the inspiration that exists within our lives. Those opportunities, any place, any time. See, if we just wait for a specific highlight, that's when I'm going to be inspired. We're going to miss the most beautiful things that we see all the time. And in this chapter, in this principle, I try to guide and think about myself, how do we see those sparks? I learned a strategy from my oldest daughter, who's named after my mom, on national radio. So you're familiar with Dennis Prager? So Dennis Prager has something on Fridays called the Happiness Hour, where he actually asks people, he says, share with me different strategies, and he talks about what it means to be happy. So it's one Friday afternoon, I'm literally, you guys would appreciate this, I'm driving down Bedford Street, I call the house, my oldest daughter answers the phone, and she says, I can't talk to you right now. I'm on hold on the Dennis Prager show. I said, okay. So I hand up the phone, and I turn on the radio, and all of a sudden, it's the Dennis Prager show. He says, it's Sarah from Stamford, Connecticut. He said, Sarah, what do you do to maintain your happiness and your inspiration? And she says, I didn't know about this until I heard it on the radio. So every day at the end of the day, I have a journal. I write down something that I'm grateful for. But, she said, I always make sure that I'm not repeating myself. It's one thing to see at the very end of the day, thank God I'm alive, Tuesday. Thank God I'm alive. Thank God. But when you train yourself to find new things, we're able to see new things to be grateful for. And then she said, when asked, how many are you up to? She said, I'm up to over 700 of them. And every day before I go to sleep, I read 50 of them. So how can I not be grateful? It's one of the keys to being inspired. The last strategy I want to share, then I'll just share briefly about the other two, is something also my father would appreciate. I asked my dad a number of years ago, how do you stay so upbeat? And he told me that you learned something actually from a rabbi at Yeshiva University many years ago, Rabbi Moshe Bestin, who again, when Jacob in the Bible, he's talking about praying to God, he makes the following statement. He says to God, I am diminished by all of my kindnesses. And what he means by that is, he's saying to himself, I may no longer be deserving of God's grace. Jacob lived with uncertainty. He never believed he was owed anything. Sometimes we walk through life and we think, oh, for sure this is going to happen. But to live with a sense of uncertainty, a sense of appreciation for every moment, of healthy insecurity, enables us to be grateful. And I knew my dad would really appreciate this because he has something in common with an actor that grew up in the same town as my father. If you get this right, you get an extra cookie tonight. Can anyone guess what town did a famous Hollywood actor and my dad grow up in? It's in Westchester. Okay, here's, I'll give you the actor. The actor is Denzel Washington.
Mount Vernon,
New York!
I was a retired teacher from Mount Vernon High School.
You knew Denzel?
No. Well, not exactly.
So I have to admit this, I read the Times, I read the Journal, every once in a while I read the Post, and I only learned this by reading page 6 of the New York Post about Denzel Washington, but then I got a reaffirmation. Somebody actually interviewed Denzel, and they said, he happens to be a very grateful guy. How do you maintain that? So he said the following. I always carry a tattered notebook with me. I never want to forget the list I maintained of job leads when I was looking for my first break in business. He understood where he came from. He never forgot that. And then in a speech that he gave, he wrote, "Give thanks for blessings every day. Embrace gratitude. It's impossible to be grateful and hateful at the same time." And then he says, "I pray that you put your slippers way under your bed at night, so that when you wake up in the morning, you have to start on your knees to find them. And while you are down there, say thank you." So that's what it means to live inspired, to appreciate the gift of every day. I want to share briefly two other principles with you, and then we'll just take some questions. The second principle is called courageous choices. Courageous choices really reflect another idea of Solomon, where Solomon says, "Better a good name than all the wealth in the world." It's a person's reputation. Knowing that we're leading a life based on the values that we truly believe in, and we don't compromise those values. The truth is, a life is made up not of major decisions, but small decisions where we have to make this choice. Do we follow conviction or convenience? Principle or pressure? And the question is, do we and how do we have the moral fortitude to make the right choices, even when nobody's looking? I believe that when somebody is convicted, God forbid, of a financial scandal, nobody leaves business school generally saying, "I know I'm going to cheat the system." Somewhere along the way, they make one decision and a second decision. And we can't underestimate the power of those decisions. A number of years ago, there was a fellow who was convicted of stealing $200 million. His name was Russell Wassendorf from Peregrine Financial Group. He tried to commit suicide. It didn't work, thank God. But he wrote a suicide note trying to explain how this happened. And he stated as follows. "I had no access to additional capital, and I was forced into a difficult decision. Should I go out of business or cheat? I guess my ego was too big to admit failure, so I cheated. I falsified the very core of the financial documents, the bank statements. One choice altered his destiny. One compromise leads to the next. Lives are ruined, and the fallout shakes the foundations of our families, businesses, governments, and schools." And I saw this played out very clearly in the summer of 2012 on the front page of the New York Times. There was a story there about the swimmers. And the New York Times said that a swimmer in the Olympics is not allowed to use something called the dolphin kick. The problem is that the referees can't figure out, because it's so close, when the person is leaving the wall, they can't see whether the swimmer is using the dolphin kick or not. So they interviewed swimmers and said, if you can get away with it, do you still do it? So one swimmer acknowledged and said, well, it's virtually impossible to be caught. After all, everyone is pushing the rules and pushing the boundaries. And if you're not doing it, you're not trying hard enough. And immediately a paragraph later, American bronze medalist Brendan Hansen said the following. "There was never a thought in my head that the extra dolphin kick or two was something I was going to do. I was not raised to cheat. It's not something I practice." He realized that a truly great life is not one guided by external regulation, but by inner motivation. He remarked that he wouldn't exploit loopholes in the rules. That it was each athlete's choice, but they will have to live with it for the rest of their lives. This world would be a radically different place if we understood more what our values are and understood how critical it is to always live by those values. I'm a Harry Potter fan, and I'm going to draw on one of my heroes, Albus Dumbledore. Albus Dumbledore, I'm going to do my best accent. If I don't get it right, you know, just forgive me for this one. But he understood it, and he said the following. It is our choices, Harry, that show what we truly are, far more than our abilities. The choices. And that's the essence of what it means to create a reputation, a life that we're proud of. One of the greatest models of that. You guys good on time? You okay? You all right? The greatest models of that was Jacob's son, Joseph. How many of you have seen the Broadway show, Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat? How many of you actually read the story in the Bible? That's close, okay. So one of the famous stories in the Bible is Joseph, and he has a last name. Anyone know what his last name is? His last name is Joseph, the Righteous One. Why is he called righteous? Because of one moment in his life when he stood for what he believed in despite the temptations around him. He was tempted by the wife of Potiphar. And by the way, Joseph was one of the only people in the Bible that says he's one of the most handsome, good-looking guys around. The women were all over him, especially the wife of Potiphar, who was his employer. And she comes to him and says, Joseph, sleep with me. He says, no. Joseph, every day she comes in. And finally, the Bible says that he refused. And the way it goes is like this, and the note is odd. It goes like this. The Hebrew word is vayimaim, vayimaim. It's up and down. One of the few places where it has a cantillation like that. And the reason is because it's reflecting his immoral ambivalence. Should I sleep with her? Should I not? Should I sleep? She's good looking. Should I not? What should I do? And then at the very last minute, the Talmud, the oral tradition, says, what held him back? What gave him the moral courage to stop? It says he saw in the window of the room the image of his father, Jacob. And I never understood that. If somebody's about to sin like that, and all of a sudden there's a knock on the door at your dad. Son, what are you doing in there? Dad, stay out. What are you doing? I mean, you know, that's no great shakes. So one of the great mystic teachers says that the greatness of Joseph was that at the moment of moral ambivalence, he was able to conjure up the image of his father. He understood that no action is private, that it reflects his family, that it reflects his future. And one of the keys to maintaining the ability to make those moral choices is to understand that we're accountable. Even if there's nobody perceivably there, we understand we're part of a chain, we're part of a connection. I was teaching a class with fathers and sons, and one of the fathers said to me, I know exactly what you're talking about. He said, when I was 11 or 10 years old, one day a friend and I decided that as a joke, we'd come up to an old woman who we saw walking in the neighborhood and pretend to ask her silly things that she couldn't possibly understand and know the answer to. The woman was hard of hearing and frail, and her confusion about our questioning was amusing to us, so we kept making fun of her. Unbeknownst to me, one of our neighbors saw this encounter and made my parents aware. My parents were flabbergasted and made two important points that I remember to this day. They asked me how I would like it if some kids treated my own grandmother the way I treated this woman. And then they said, when I behaved in this manner, I not only ruined my own reputation, but the reputation of my parents and the entire family. As punishment, I had to purchase a few dozen roses with my allowance and stand by the neighborhood supermarket, purposely a public location, all afternoon, handing out individual flowers to every older person I saw. It was a lesson learned and never forgotten. And that to me is, in essence, what it means to lead a courageous life. I interviewed Senator Lieberman, who many of us know well. He wrote the foreword to the book. And in the chapter here, I just want to share his last point about this. When I asked about him, about his career, he said the following. When I decide a course of action, it's not for fear of failure. If I lose because I stood for my beliefs, I will always be at peace. I never want to be remembered for playing life safe. I want to be remembered for doing what was right. And that's something that also we try to cultivate within our life as well. You ready for one last principle?
Yeah.
Okay, that was weak. You sure?
Yeah.
All right. So last principle is called discovering your Elijah moment. Some of you may have seen about this, heard about it a little bit. And it relates to a phenomenon I've seen at funerals that I've done. And that is what I call the standing room only phenomenon. There's sometimes people that are at a funeral, and if you could ask the deceased who that person is, they wouldn't remember who that was. If you could ask the family or friends, they would have no idea. But the person is there because of one moment in time. That individual shared a little bit of their light with that person. And that changed that person's life. And the essence of this story, this idea is captivated in a story about another famous mystic called the Baal Shem Tov. How many of you have heard of or seen Elijah the prophet before? All right, a couple. He comes around. Elijah the prophet is known for being there sometimes in the Bible, at least in tradition. He's there to Passover Seder. He's there to kind of help people along. So this person goes to the mystic and says, I want to see Elijah the prophet. I've perfected myself. So the mystic says, I want you to take food and spend the Shabbat, spend the Sabbath with this widow in the forest and her children. And if you go there, you'll see Elijah the prophet. So he goes there Friday afternoon, Friday night, Saturday, no Elijah. Saturday night, he still doesn't see Elijah. He's very disappointed. He comes back to the mystic and he says, you promised me I'd see Elijah the prophet. So he says, go back, same thing. Take the food and go back to this house. So he goes back. It's Friday afternoon. He's within earshot of the home, and he hears a child crying out to a mother, saying, Mommy, where are we going to get food from this Sabbath? And the mother turns to the child and says, just like Elijah came last week, Elijah is going to come again this week. And it's in that moment that he realized that he was the Elijah the world was waiting for. Mark Twain said something very poignant. He said, the two most important days of our lives are the day we're born and the day we understand why. The day we understand why. And I want to share an example of this. I was speaking up in Hartford a number of years ago, and I asked a group of people, tell me about one of the most inspirational moments in your life that you felt connected. And a woman said the following. She said, I was in the supermarket at the Big Y supermarket, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw an elderly man with orthopedic shoes slowly exiting his car, and I noticed that one of his shoes was untied. I'm not sure what possessed me, but I went over to him and asked if I could help him tie his shoes, as I knew it would be hard for him to bend down. With tears in her eyes, she shared that in that instant, she felt closer to God than almost ever before in her life. Almost the entire group welled up in tears, and she wondered why she became so emotional when sharing her story. I explained that in those few seconds, when she intuitively sensed her ability to become a messenger for God, her soul was on fire. It was her Elijah moment. And those opportunities are everywhere. Those opportunities are everywhere. As many of you know, one of the places I like to hang out, I know you saw me at Borders, which doesn't exist anymore, but I like to hang out at Starbucks. Hey, one of my Starbucks buddies. A few of them. And it's interesting, I kind of sit on one side and I do my little Starbucks ministry, and there's a deacon on the other side who does his Starbucks ministry, and we share Bible thoughts. It's fascinating. I said to him, why do you do what you do? And he reads the Bible and he talks to people and stuff like that. I see more people in Starbucks during the week than I do in my synagogue. That's why I hang out there. You know, Shabbat, I see a lot. But then he said to me this. You see, back in 1996, I experienced tremendous difficulty in my personal life, and as a result, became very discouraged and depressed. I found it very difficult to get through life on a daily basis, and I needed moral support. One evening, while coming home from work, I met an elderly gentleman on the New York City No. 5 train heading uptown from Wall Street. He came on the train of 14th Street and immediately saw the sadness in my eyes. He reached out to me and started a conversation, questioning how I was feeling. I was so desperate that I came off the next stop at 42nd Street and bared my soul to a complete stranger. He was a kind and compassionate listener. After pouring my soul out to him for an hour, he assured me that things would get better, and he gave me his phone number to call him whenever I needed a listening ear. I called him for 5 consecutive days and spoke about the many things that were on my mind. He just listened. By day number 6, I had a very supernatural experience. I felt my heavy burdens physically lifting off my body, and I felt a strong sense of God entering. Ever since that event, I started a ministry for reaching out to strangers. A stranger reached out to me and made the difference that I needed. I was then led by God to encourage others during the very early morning hours at Starbucks location. My soul now sings at Starbucks every morning, and there are times when I think he was an angel. If we lead our lives, what I would say, walking into a room, any place we go, and say, how am I going to make somebody's day today? This world would be so much a brighter place. There's a mystic that said many years ago, my job in life is not to resurrect the dead. My job in life is to resurrect the living. Most people are just walking. They're not just surviving. But they're not realizing in every human encounter, there's an opportunity to spread a little bit of light. The world is filled with chaos. It's filled with challenges. But a little bit of light can really illuminate a corner of the world and make a difference. I thought about that also. You know, I started as you heard, I was on a radio show, and Pastor Greg Dahl and I, a number of years ago, started something called the Elijah Moment campaign. There's a Facebook page called Elijah Moment, that in a world of increasing acts of violence, we need to do and flood the world with acts of kindness. And that's simple. Saying hello, seeing how somebody's doing, you know, paying for something, just helping out. And the opportunities are endless, because if that's the attitude that we have, our lives will be so much more enriched than the world around us as well. Just last 2 Elijah Moment stories, then I'll take some questions. You know, it was 9/11. I started with that a number of years ago, and I was listening to CBS 880 radio, and there was a police officer that was being interviewed by a reporter, and he said, today's a great day. And they said, why? He said, well, somebody just gave me a $20 bill. I said, why? Well, just to say thank you very much for what you do to protect our city. So I was sitting in my car at the Ridgeway Shopping Center, and I said, I can just let that go in one ear and out the other, or I can do the pay it forward Starbucks experiment. So I decided to go back into the Starbucks. It's how kind of you get guided in these ways with these Elijah moments. I go back in and I say to the cashier, pay for the next person's coffee. I take a step back and there's a young man there with a baby. And she says, oh, he's the one who paid for your coffee. He walks over to me and says, why did you do that? I said, oh, it's 9/11. I just want to share a little bit of goodwill. He says to me, that means a lot because I was at ground zero on 9/11. I said, what were you doing at ground zero on 9/11? He said, I'm a retired New York City police officer. And here I realized, I had no idea. But offering that act of kindness, God orchestrated a way for me to be able to really brighten somebody's life. Somebody wrote into us, and many people wrote in about their Elijah moments. This is local here. There's a fellow, actually, that's standing. When you try to get on the merit, I don't know if you know this, on High Ridge, when you try to get on the merit, there's a guy who's there every Sunday, or there used to be, selling newspapers. So there's a person in our community, whenever they go there, if they see the newspapers, they buy all the newspapers. They just pay for all the newspapers. What is it, $20, $30? You're making that person's day, and you're sharing a little bit of kindness. That place becomes a holy place. A woman wrote into us, and I had no idea what this was. She said, I am a NODA, N-O-D-A. Does anyone know what the word NODA is? Yeah. She said, I am a NODA, which is a No One Dies Alone volunteer at Stamford Hospital. We stay with patients at the end of their lives who don't have loved ones available to be with them. We become their loved ones as they leave this world. In September, I sat with a cognitively disabled man several times. After my first visit, he was awake and I fed him vanilla ice cream. By the last visit, he was heavily sedated and nearing the end of his life. I held his hand and somehow felt even more connected to this patient than I had to others that I sat with. A few weeks ago, I shared my experience with my family and found out that this gentleman's father was the doctor who delivered me in Stamford Hospital in 1956. His father was there to help my arrival into this world, and I was there to help his son's departure 58 years later. That was my Elijah moment. And these opportunities are all over the place. The last principle that I speak about is called discovering your renewable energy. Every day, I learned this from a great woman, her name is Rebbetzin Esther Youngres, who really had phenomenal energy, and I once talked to her. She really tried to bring light every place she went. And I said to her, how do you do it? She always felt like she was on fire. And she said, I always pray to God 3 times a day that I'm a conduit for God's blessings in the world. And she quoted the verse in Isaiah where it says, those who have faith in God, their strength will be renewed. There's no such thing as retirement. Moses started his job at 80 years old. Aaron was 83. Abraham was 75. You may retire from your job, but we never retire from life. Every day is a gift. What I can accomplish today, I cannot have accomplished yesterday, and I won't be able to accomplish tomorrow. And that's ultimately, with that awareness, that we are simply here not to bring glory to ourselves, but bring a little more light into the world. Realize our divine potential. Seize the urgency of every moment. Make every day a masterpiece. If we remember that, then God willing, not only will we lead lives of legacy for how we want to be remembered, but God will bless us to lead lives of impact, lives that are spiritually great, and lives ultimately of much, much fulfillment. So thank you very much for your time. Questions if you want, then the books are available. Just a couple things if you want to spread the word. I just want to share it now before people go. We are blessed, by the way, to have a billboard actually up in Times Square for the month of February about this topic. If you do like the book, share on social media. There's a website, www.whatwillthaysay.com. That's all you need. Whatwillthaysay.com. That's a way to link to buy the book. If you like it, write a review for the book, right, Emery? Write a review of the book. But please share the word because I just think, you know, it's not about the books, but really it's about hopefully changing ourselves and changing people's lives and the world around us. So thank you. Yeah?
It's not a question, but something interesting.
Yes.
When my granddaughter applied to colleges, she wrote about me. And she said, I let you read it only if you promise not to cry. I read it. And I didn't cry, but I said that could be my attitude. So powerful. And guess what now? I didn't realize it then. It was long ago. And now, whenever I falter, and I do, she said, Sati, remember, live up to
what. That's beautiful. That's,
isn't that one?
That is, it's a great motto, what this is about.
Isn't that good?
Yes. God should bless you with
so
a beautiful
lucky,
life.
I count my blessings. I don't always manage to do it, but she reminds me.
What's your name?
My name is Esther. Her name is Danielle.
Very nice. She has a lot of
But look,
that's great.
It took me a while to realize.
Yeah.
And I'm
yeah.
lucky.
That's beautiful. Thank you for sharing. Thanks.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Just want to pass along the comment. I was reading about Warren Buffett a couple of days ago in a newspaper.
Yeah.
And he said,
it's in the book, by the way.
He said, okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
He said it takes 20 years to build a great reputation. Five minutes
to destroy it. Yeah, I do quote him here. I call it the 25 rule. It's true. It's a very good point. Thank you. Any other thoughts, questions? Yeah. Yeah, come on up. Yeah, that's a photo. Learned a lot from my father, so much, yeah. And my father also, by the way, wrote a book recently. Check it out, I'll go through the picture. Wait, with the book. Thanks. He wrote a book actually called Kosher Movies. It has nothing to do with sex or violence in movies, but rather it's life lessons from film. So if you just go online, he's got a cable show going too.
It's also in the Jewish Historical Society Library at JCC.
There you go. Very good. Yes?
I once had a driver, only driving myself to the airport, this particular time happened to be going to the airport. He told me the story about how he was a fairly well-paid executive responsible for the gas stations on the Parrot Parkway. And something happened, or somebody took cigarettes, money, whatever. He ended up being responsible. Somebody was on vacation. He ended up having to take a fall for whatever happened. Mm-hmm. and he went into a tremendous depression. He was a highly educated person. And he said he just couldn't get himself out of it. So one day he's driving on the street in New York. And he stopped at a stoplight. And he turns and he sees a fellow who was going to a garbage can, picking up cans and drinking whatever's left over in the can. And he says, here I am, moping around, so unhappy. Here's a fellow who's got to go through. And that was enough. That experience was enough to shake him. That was the
point. Yeah, I mean, that's true. It helps to make helps him realize what he should be grateful for. 100%. It's a great example. Well, thank you very much. I'll be here for the books again. Thanks for your support.
Dr. Cohen, we have two wonderful blessings: a blessing of his inspirational speech and a book which is available for us, and the blessing that our friends Aaron and the people at the Bennett Library open their space to everyone. Us and to everyone, and that really is a blessing that we can share our ideas, our knowledge, our learning from all parts of the citizens of Stamford from different points of view. That's really truly a blessing.
Thank you.
And we're looking for, please come and talk to Rabbi Cohen. Come
get a book. Thanks a lot.
And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.